14, the Gospel of John, chapter number 14, and while you're finding your places, this evening to the Gospel of John,
Thank you. website because we don't have one. We've got to put everything in there on it. Yes. Francis White. All right. Any others? I'm going to pray y'all smile. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. We've got that one. Thank you. Yes, ma'am. We got that one. She's in hospital, very bad off. Need to remember her in prayer. Like I said, I'm going to pray y'all a smile. That would help me a great deal. All right. If you can't smile at me, look at the monkey over here, and that'll make you smile. Yes, ma'am. He's still no better. Anybody else tonight before we pray? Yes, ma'am.
Rose Lane. She was diagnosed with breast cancer again and it is spread to her spine.
Oh, my. Rose Lane. Okay. There's two reasons I repeat them. Number one, make sure I heard them right. And number two, let the people over the internet hear it. So I'm not trying to give you all a hard time. Anybody else before we pray? All right, let's have a good season of prayer. Our Father, we love you tonight. We thank you for loving us. I thank you for everyone who's took time out of their busy schedules to come and to pray and to seek the face of God. Father, we pray for tonight, Trinity. We pray for Ruby, for Date, for Brother Jamie Coles, who's recovering from his surgery. The Tickle family who are all at home with a stomach virus tonight. We pray for Vicki Cassida, who's in very serious condition. We do pray for the family of Noah Frye. Pray that you'd be with them, Polly and Jeanette and the boys and the loss of Brother Frye. Pray for Liz Thompson as she recovers from her surgery. For Beverly Keene, who's in Danville Regional Medical Center. Lord, she'll be going to a rehab in the next few days. Lord, just have the antibiotics to work and to be able to get her back on her feet quickly. We pray for Danny Warwick as he recovers from his surgery. For Jack Dale and his upcoming surgery. For Diane Mills, who's very sick with a cold. Bonnie Rains has also been very sick. We pray for Brother Scott Bean, his back, Lord. Just hope they'll find out from the MRI Monday what they can do to help him. We pray for the Hart family and the loss of the 22-year-old son. We pray for Cindy Rutherford's hip. We pray for the family of Leslie Adkins. We pray for Alan Taylor and his heart. For Francis White, who's in rehab. For Austin Begley, they'll be able to find out what's wrong with him. For Vicki and Robert Reed. For Rose Lane, who's battling cancer. Father, we just pray that you'd reach down tonight and meet every need on our prayer list, Lord. We pray that you'd reach down and touch lives and change hearts. We pray that you'd draw us closer to you as we love you and serve you. Father, bless the service tonight. Lord, speak to our hearts. Help us leave here different than we came. And we praise you and thank you for all you're going to do before you do it. In Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people said, all right, stand. It's going to get harder as you go. Smile. Now pick up your songbook, and Jamie will tell you the rest. His arms hurt, but his mouth is working well.
True, that is true. All right, page number 431. We'll sing the first, second, and last verse of Silent Night. Yeah.
Sean Horbit. Come on. Well, the other name is Ugly Sean, but we'll take both of them. All right. It's time to get back to the Lord, that which He's so bountifully given to us. Got a lot coming up here in the next few weeks, especially, Sean, especially on January the 16th, when we'll have our one-day mini-camp meeting. We'll have 10 o'clock a.m., Brother Smokey Wilson. Where there's smoke, there's fire. So he'll be burning at 10 o'clock. And then 11 o'clock, Smokey will sing again. Then Brother John Mitchell, I talked to him today. He'll be here with bells on, and he'll be ready to preach the house down that morning. Then that night, we'll have the Down East Boys. They'll be singing for us. And then Brother Noah, he must be thinking about me in heaven. Brother John Mitchell will preach that night. And so don't come to go on Sunday night, because you ain't getting out early that night. We're going to be here for a while. But that's all right. We're going to kick your slats out and have a good time. Say amen. All right. Every head's bowed, every eyes closed. Brother Sean Horbit, you get up to the microphone and ask God to bless the offering placer.
Our Father in heaven, thank you for tonight, Lord. Thank you for all that you do. Lord, bless this offering. Lord, I pray in Jesus' name that give, help to further your kingdom. Pray for souls be saved, lives be changed. And thank you for all that you need. In Jesus' name, pray. Amen.
Ago Sunday, I had lunch with Brother Frye. He preached in Branch, and when I saw him, I couldn't look at him. He was in worse shape than I'd ever seen him in his life. They had to help him in or out of the car. I don't know how in the world he preached 2 weeks ago. I have no idea. You've heard the statement, seeing a dead man walking. That's what I saw that day. But when you sit down in front of that sirloin, he come to life. He said, that's the biggest sirloin I ever seen in my life. And then he commenced eating that, and then they bought him a big old plate of shrimp. He said, is all this mine? I said, yes, sir, Brother Frye, it's all yours. You just eat away, and what you don't eat will send to Polly. And he just grinned from ear to ear. And then that Friday, they put him back in the hospital and had to do an oblation, which is the destruction of a nerve so the bottom of the heart would work faster than the top of the heart, trying to pump fluid off. They took off 7 liters of fluid out of his lungs and out of his around his heart and his liver, because his liver had started to fail him as well. And Jeanette called me then, and she told me, she said, it's not about quantity of time, it's about quality of life. I knew then that that wasn't going to be much longer. So they had told him he could go back to rehab, so they'd been taking him to rehab yesterday. They went to take him back this morning. They got him in the car, and he just laid back in the seat and had a massive heart attack, went home to be with the Lord. And so I'm going to be honest with you. I'm not in no frame to preach. So I thought the best thing to do is let Brother Frye preach. So miracle working Ken, it wasn't working until 5 minutes after the service, I don't think, but I think he got it all worked out. So let's just listen to Brother Frye preach one more time.
Open your Bibles, please, this evening to the Gospel of John, chapter number 14. The Gospel of John, chapter number 14. And while you're finding your places in the Word of God, again, it's a joy and a privilege to be here at Temple Baptist Church. And I appreciate this church, and I appreciate you, dear folk. I appreciate my wife, Miss Polly, being with me. We've been married 64 years, working on our 65th year. And she hadn't been with me down to Mississippi in 3 years, and so she came this year, and I'm so glad to have her with me. And then I have enjoyed the fellowship here. Let me just take a moment to say this, that and this artist. Brother Shook, thank you for the message. When I was your age, I stayed down there. As you're going to know tonight, my brother, I'm going to stay up here. Because when you get my age, it takes all the energy that you can get to stay up here. Thank you for the message. Good to see you again. It's a shame we live 25 miles apart. Had to come to Mississippi to see each other. And thank you for the letter you wrote me last year. I have it in my briefcase. I keep letters like that. A letter of encouragement. Thank you. Well, let me just take a moment here to thank the Lord for Dr. Steve Crane, his wife, Sister Val. I did meet them in a place. Now, this took me a year to learn how to pronounce it. It's Homosassa Springs, Florida. You can't say that fast. That's where I met them at. And we have been knowing each other all these years, the pastor said. He's talking about that fish. I thought you were going to tell that time I shoved Brother Bell in the ocean. That's what I thought you was going to tell. We've been out fishing. Remember that, Brother Richard? And he had a bologna sandwich in his hand. And we came into dock, and I thought they told me to push, and they wanted me to pull. And I pushed, and he had hold that boat, and down he went. And he's got a pacemaker, a defibrillator. And I thought I'd have to go down and get him. But somewhere down, the only thing he complained about was he lost his bologna sandwich while he was down. It's amazing. And so let me mention this. Brother G.S. Crane, he and his dear wife. Oh, I love this brother. I love this brother. Many times in the last several years, I've used his testimony in my messages. Thank you for your stickability, my brother. And then Brother Bell hit his wife. Our friends, and he and I went back here to pray together this evening. And I said to him, I'm glad you're my friend. I can talk to you about anything without being embarrassed. I like friends like that. And then Brother Ferrette, he and his dear wife, I'm so happy to represent Beam's ministers across this country. My good friend, Brother Ferrette, his wife. And I'll tell you what, outside of being saved, the next greatest thing is have a copy of the Word of God in your hand. And I'm so glad I was here yesterday as they celebrated 40 years of the establishment of this church. And then my brother friend back there, Brother Charlie, I met him here the first time I came down. But then a hurricane did come, and the water came to the door, but they moved me to another story. They moved me to higher ground. Well, I have enjoyed the singing.
Yeah.
Thank God for these young people.
Yeah.
They are the church of today, not tomorrow. And thank God for their songs. Thank you, choir.
Yes.
Thank you, choir, for those good songs. Sister Jackie, oh, what a good job. They've done a great job on that song. All right, if you could, please, would you stand this evening as we read the Word of God together? After reading God's Word together, please remain standing for prayer time, and I'd appreciate that. In John 14, beginning at verses 1 through verses number 3, let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, and where I am, that you may be also. My Heavenly Father, I come before you this evening in the name of the Lord Jesus. Again, I want to thank you for Calvary. And Father, I'm so glad that I have down through the years learned that Calvary is more than just a hill. But it's a place where you allowed your begotten Son to go some 2,000 years ago and die for sinners such as I. Now, my Father, as I stand before you this evening and this waiting congregation, I pray that thou shalt give me holy unction to preach your word this evening. I'm praying, God, that when the word of God is preached, the souls will be saved. And the saints of God will be helped and encouraged. Now, Father, would you bless this church and all of its ministries? I pray for every visitor that's in this audience. And I pray for every member of this church. And every preacher, pastor, missionary, evangelist, I pray for them. Then, Brother Steve, Lord, he and his dear wife, would you help him, encourage him as he under shepherds this church? And bless this jubilee. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. You may be seated, and thank you for standing in reverence to the reading of the Word of God. questions. I just want to read the verse. This I say, then walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. I'm glad we have been born of God's Spirit. Therefore, we walk in the Spirit of God. Before I begin the message, and I have a rather long introduction to this message, I have preached in the last 13 years in almost 600 churches. We're on the road 48 weeks out of a year. And everywhere that my wife and I travel, I see preachers, pastors, under so much pressure today. I see church members hurting today. And some are throwing in the flag of surrender and said, I'm going to quit right here. Then we wonder, is it worth the journey? Well, I've been out here now almost 60 years preaching the gospel. And I want to preach tonight on this thought, will heaven be worth it? And I want to give you some reasons why that I believe, of all the trials and heartaches and storms, that heaven will be worth everything. Let me give you the introduction. I suppose everyone in this room believes in heaven. I would imagine that everyone in this room are longing to go there someday. And so the thought of there being a better place for the saints of God to live after their time on earth has ended has cheered the hearts of God's people for thousands of years. Even Abraham, who lived some 3,500 years ago, longed to go to heaven when he died. We find in Hebrews chapter 11, verses 8 through 10, by faith Abraham, when he was called to go out into a place which he should after receive for an inheritance, obeyed. And went out not knowing whether he went. By faith he sojourned in the land of promise as in a strange country, dwelling in tabernacles with Isaac and Jacob, heirs with him of the same promise. For he looked for a city which hath foundation, whose builder and maker is God. As Abraham said, I'm looking for a city. I'm looking for a city tonight. I'm looking for a city. So Abraham caught a glimpse of that city and said, it's worth it. It's worth leaving home and family. It's worth being a stranger and a pilgrim. It's worth hardship and pain. Heaven is surely worth it all. Then Simon Peter had a little insight into the inheritance that awaits every child of God in heaven. And he wrote about it in the book of 1 Peter chapter 1 and verses 3 through verses number 5. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Notice now, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled, and that fadeth not away. Notice what? Reserved for you in heaven, who are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. Then Simon Peter caught a glimpse of heaven. He said, it's worth it. It's worth a total change in my life. It's worth the hardship I have endured. It's worth more than my very life. Heaven is surely worth it all. And then on the Isle of Patmos, the Apostle John received a clear revelation of what that city looked like and of all the glories that it contains. And so he wrote extensively about heaven in Revelation chapter 7 and verses 21 and 22. John saw heaven and said, it's worth it. It's worth being exiled from home, from family, he said, and friends. It's worth the loneliness, the pain, the suffering, and the high cost I've been called to pay. I've seen that city in heaven will surely be worth it all. sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly therefore will I rather glory in my infirmity, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities, in persecution, in distress for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then am I strong. And that one vision of heaven was enough to strengthen Paul as he faced the many trials that came his way. By the way, I'll illustration again in 2 Corinthians chapter 11 and verses 22 through 32. He talks about heaven is worth all the pain. He said, that comes my way. It's worth the hatred and the persecution. It's worth the sorrow and the attacks that I've seen. That shit in heaven is surely worth it all. Then he said also, the fact is, no, listen, we don't have a whole lot of information about heaven. Think about this. We don't have a lot of information about heaven. The Bible gives us just enough to whet our appetite for that city. The odd part is that while we do not know a whole lot about heaven, but God has put that desire within every single child of God to go there.
Amen.
I have never been there. I don't know what the Bible says about it. But since today God saved me, there's been a desire in my heart to go to heaven. Also, we come to faith in Jesus. He changes our lives immediately. And then the battle begins. Let me say, church, when I first got saved, I thought all of my troubles were behind me. Oh, they just had begun. I'm talking about trials and troubles like I've never known before. But thank God I have a friend who said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. I'll go with you all the way. So we fight battles with the flesh, the world, and the devil. Sometimes we win. Sometimes we lose, but we never stop heading toward heaven. When the Lord saved us, he placed within us a desire to be with him there. So we walk. We fight. We rejoice. We suffer. We win. We lose. We stumble and fall. We get up and go again. All because we like those great saints I mentioned just a few moments ago. They pressed on toward the mark. And because of their encouragement, we press on toward the mark. New heaven, new worth it all. So we have caught a glimpse of that palace we have never seen, and we want to be there more than we want to be here. Isn't this amazing? I get our introduction in just a moment. Again, by the way of illustration, in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, in the first 8 verses, for we know that if our earthly house of this tabernacle were dissolved, we have a building of God, and house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. For in this we go earnestly, desiring to be clothed upon with our house which is from heaven. And so be that being clothed, we shall not be found naked. Notice now, for we that are in this tabernacle do groan, being burdened not that we be unclothed, but clothed upon, that mortality might be swallowed up of life. Now he that hath wrought us for the selfsame thing is God, who also years ago, I cannot recall. But back some years ago as a young preacher and a pastor, and I was a radio broadcaster for 40 years. And so this preacher from Richmond, Virginia, called me and heard my broadcast in Appomattox, Virginia. And he said, I heard your broadcast, I like your preaching, could you come and do a meeting for me? And so I set a day to go do a meeting for him. And I got to the church, I never met him before. I never been to his church before. And so he greeted me in the church parking lot. And he said, now, Brother Frye, I don't have no fancy house to put you in. My wife and I, we do not have a house. We're living in three classrooms. But I'm going to put you in the best motel that we can afford. And when I went down there, he said, it's not, let me tell you, it's not much to brag about. It certainly was not, because I've seen roaches. This is an exaggeration now, big enough to put saddles on, I thought. And so I preached that week, and he kept on with me back. And I've been there 22 times. He came to me on my 22nd time. He said, Brother Fine, I'm not going to book you back. And he kept telling me, when I get my inheritance, this is the Baptist preacher now, I'm going to build me a house, and I'm going to build you a room on that house. This is the Baptist preacher talking. And so the 22nd time, he said, now, Brother Fine, I am not going to book you back until I get my house done, because I have my inheritance now. And so a year went by, a year and a half went by. Of course, we talked by telephone, but he never gave me a progress that the house was going. And almost 2 years, he called me and he said, now, Brother Frye, can you come and do a meeting for me? My house is done, and your room is finished for you. And so I gave him a date, and I remember from my house to Richmond to the church, 5.5-hour drive. But ladies and gentlemen, when I traveled that 5.5-hour drive, I do not remember that drive. I had one thing on my mind, was that house and my room. I'm not going back to the old rundown motel room this year. And then when I preached that night, I cannot tell you what I preached about that night. I had one thing on my mind, that house. That house. And so when the meeting was over, he said, follow me to my house. So we went out in the country, we drove up in the driveway, and it seemed to me that this house covered a city block, three-door garage. And so I went into this entrance right here, and on the right, he said, this is my prophet's quarters. I've never seen a prophet's quarters like that. On my left is my utility room. I've never seen one like that. Went down the hallway, and he said, now, this is my breakfast nook. Now, I'm a plowboy preacher. I'm from the country. And what in this world is a breakfast nook? I did not know until about 3 weeks ago what a breakfast nook was. And so I looked at that and went to the left of the dining room. And I counted 24 sittings with a chandelier hanging over the center of that table. But you know, that's not really an interest to me. As he gives me a tour of that house. And finally we come to my room. Are you still with me now? We come to my room. The door is closed. He said, now, Brother Fire, this is your room. We built especially for you. And I opened that door, and I stepped in, and it was done in blue. It seemed like I just stepped up to the atmosphere of heaven. I had never walked in a room like that. And then he said, I want you to lay down on that bed right there. I laid down that bed. He said, we paid $3,000 for this mattress for you to sleep on this week. I said to myself, oh, plowboy, you come a long way from a straw tick to a $3,000 mattress. You come a long ways. And so he showed me my bathroom, bigger than the living room that we have. I'm not exaggerating now. And it was done in blue. Went out in that breakfast nook and had lasagna. He retired for the evening. And sometime during the night, I awakened someone in my room singing Amazing Grace, and I thought I'd done died and gone to heaven. He got up in the morning, and through the house, he had an intercom system playing that song to me, God's Amazing Grace. Now, that's as close as I've ever been to a mansion. That's as close as I have ever slept in a mansion. With no compassion for what we're going to have one day. Jesus sat in my Father's house. By the way, he had inherited $5 million. Oh, what a change. But I must go on. Again, we find when John described the city, he saw Revelation 20. touch us in glory. In Revelation chapter number 21, verses 4, and God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, and neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. Get this now, no one will die, no hearts will break, no one will weep, no one will hurt, no one will have to work and strive just to make it in this world. Every saint of God will enjoy the perfection of that city along with the presence of our Savior and His Father. All this is enough to make me want to go there more today than ever before. So consider a place called heaven. Number two, let's consider the population of heaven. So we find here the sovereign God's will be there. Heaven, is the Father's house. And notice he'll be there. One day we'll be with God in his house and we'll see him there. In Revelation 22 in verses 3 and 4, and there shall be no more curse, but the throne of God and the Lamb shall be in, and his servants shall serve him, and they shall see his face. His name shall be in their foreheads. I've never seen God's face, and neither have you. Moses wanted to see him. He said, Moses, if you do, you can't live. But there's a cliff on the rock. I put you there. When I pass by, you see my hand apart. But one day, we shall see him face to face. We look through a glass, which is now darkened. But one day, it shall be erased. Some golden daybreak, we shall see him face to face. Then again, I like what Job said here. This is Job's hope. For I know that my Redeemer liveth, that he shall stand at the latter day upon the earth. And though after my skin worms destroy this body, yet in my flesh shall I see God. Whom shall I see for myself? Mine eyes shall behold, and not another, though my race shall be consumed with me, or within me. Let me say, that was Job's hope. This is my hope. I'm so glad when God saved me, he gave me a living hope. Oh, when I think about this, ladies and gentlemen, I go back and I look at the Gospel of John chapter number 1, and I look at verses number 11, where the Bible said that Jesus came unto his own, and his own received him not. Let me say, for 400 years they've been looking, waiting for the Messiah. Now that he's come, they do not believe that he's Messiah. To that Jew that's never been saved, they're still looking for him. At that time, we was not a people. We had no hope. But I like verses number 12. Even the Jews called us dogs. But I like verse number 12 in that chapter. But as many as received him, to them gave he the power to become the sons of God. Even to them that believe on his name, when there was no way, he became our way. When there was no hope, he became our hope. When there was no life, he died to give us life.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Will heaven be worth it all?
Yes.
Will heaven be worth it all? Then in 1 John 3, verse number 2, beloved, now are we the sons of God. And it doth not yet appear what we shall be. But we know that when he shall appear, we shall see him, for we shall see him as he is. The Son of God will be there. Jesus said, I will come again and receive you into myself, that where I am, there you may be also. The redeemed saints of God will spend eternity with the very Lord who paid the price for their redemption when he died on an old rugged cross. And then we find, number 3, the saints of God will be there. Jesus said that where I am, there you may be also. We find the saints of God from the Old Testament will be there. The saints of God from the New Testament will be there. All the saints of God from the church age will be there. Our redeemed loved ones will be there. Friends and family will all join in that land someday. Not a single redeemed son of God will be missing. Not a seat at the table in glory will be empty. They shall all be filled. A preacher asked me some weeks ago, he said, Brother Frye, do you think our church will ever have another perfect attendance? I said, not in this walk of life. You never get them after ordination day, you organize, no more will you have 100%. Always find an excuse not to be there. But one day, when we all get home, not one seat will be empty. Will heaven be worth it? Then again, the Bible said, and I think Paul said it good right here. In the book of 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 and verses 13 through 18, that I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that you sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even, notice now, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we said to you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, with the trumpet of God,
appreciated. You labor for the Lord. You serve God, and sometimes it seems that you're unappreciated. Sometimes you're misunderstood. Sometimes you give everything you have and it appears to accomplish nothing. Yet you labor on because you want to honor the Lord with your life. You labor on because you know it's the right thing to do. You labor on because you know something better is waiting down the road. You labor on because you know that heaven awaits. You labor on because you know there is a place of rest. And then again, let us labor for him while we can, so that when we meet him, we'll hear him say in Matthew 25:21, his Lord said unto him, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things. I will make thee ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy of thy Lord." Last week, my wife went to see the doctor for a checkup. We have a fine Christian doctor, Dr. Peter Roby. He exalts the Lord in his work, his testimony. And he's not only a good doctor, but he's a good Christian man. And he looked at me and my wife. See, we're 82 years young. He said, "Have you considered retirement?" I said, "What is that word, doctor?" "You don't retire in the service of God. You might retire from your sentence, but not in the service of God." I said, "No, doctor, we press on because one more soul will be worth it all. Be worth it all. We see no retirement in our future, but we see the coming of our Savior. Where we're going to go one day and rest from all of our labors." You said, Brother Frye, there's your journey. Get hard. The roads get hard and long. And the battles come. That heaven will be worth it all. And we get there one day. Then we have number two, the promise of rescue. Jesus said, "I will come again, receive it to myself." When that rescue comes and we leave this world, none of the evils that trouble us here will allow to follow us there. Listen to this promise. All the troubles we face here cannot follow us to our new home. You leave them all behind. Amen. You leave your money behind. You leave your cars behind. You leave everything you've accomplished, material behind. You can't take a thing. We won't need it over there. Nowhere. Now, Revelation 21:27. "And there shall in no wise enter into anything that defileth, either whatsoever work of abomination, or make it alive, but they which are written in the Lamb's book of life." So we have the promise of the union. Jesus made this promise to his people, that where I am, there you may be also. You see, we'll be with him, and that will be heaven for us. Just to be with him will be heaven. Amen. Can you say amen there? Amen. By the way, not only will we be with him, but we'll be also like him. Amen. Can you imagine this? One day, I made it two now, but one day I'm going back to 33 and a half. I'm not going up, I'm going to go down. And my body now gets tired. And I got wrinkles and I got eyeglasses and false teeth, and I thank God for all of them. But one day we'll have to have those. One day we'll get a body that will never tire, will never wear out, and never die. Because we're going to have a body just like our Lord. Will heaven be worth it? It sure will. It sure will. Again, we receive bodies. Oh, and that Bible says we'll be changed. He says in 1 Corinthians 15, "Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye. And the last trumpet, the trumpet shall sound. The dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruption must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So then this corrupt must have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality. Then shall be brought to pass the saying, there's written, death is swallowed up in victory." 1 Corinthians 15:51-54. As I conclude, I think heaven will be worth it all, don't you?
Yes.
As I conclude, I can sing like these young men. I can sing like these young ladies. But I'm going to read my song tonight. I got a song right here, but when I try to get it out, something happens to it. It gets all cracked up. But I got the song here. And here's the song I'm talking about. "Often I'm hindered on my way. Burden so heavy, I almost fall. Then I hear Jesus sweep and says, heaven will surely be worth it all. Many the trials, toils, and tears, many a heartache may hear Paul. But the dear Lord so truly says, heaven will surely be worth it all. Toiling and pain, I will endure. years old, walked the aisle and got saved.
Amen.
Last week we had four precious souls to walk the aisle and get saved. On Tuesday night I seen them three deep at the altar praying for their lost loved ones. I believe it's time that we wake up. I believe it's time that we quit playing church. Get down to business with God. If you're ever going to shout and praise God, do it down here. Now, I'm not a singer, but they tell me, these people that sing these songs, is this right, Brother Josh? You got to sing it 300 times to know it. Is that right?
Sounds about right.
That's what they say. I've talked to some of these professionals. They said to sing a song, really do it right, you got to do it at least 300 times. That's a lot of practice. That's a lot of practice. Well, you said, Brother Frye, I believe what the Bible says about shouting and praising God, but I'll wait to get heaven. No, I won't practice down here. I won't be a stranger when I get up there. You won't either. Why not get in practice down here? Why wait till you get there? That was like some years ago in the land of Haiti, the poorest country in the hemisphere. Myself and a man from Arkansas, from Emmanuel Baptist Church, I believe the name of the church was, witnessed this young man 200 miles to the closest city, no electricity. And this man took a silver dollar. He wanted to make me a gift. He had a sardine can and had a little fish oil in it and a string. And he took and lit that string, feed it out of that fish oil to melt the silver to make me a wedding band. I have that today. And he had a cloth. He shined till the smoke came from that cloth. And this man that was with me, he said, when I get back to Arkansas, I go to church with us, over 700. We will have them praying for you to get saved. The young man said, what's wrong right now? And I said, now's the time. So we led him to the Lord. We didn't wait till we got where 700 was. He got saved then. He said, what's wrong with that? That stuck in my heart. If you're not saved, what's wrong with tonight?
Yes.
But if you're saved and you're right with God, what's wrong tonight? Would heaven be worth it, Yeshua? Would you stand, please? I'm going to pray. The pastor's going to come with the invitation. My Heavenly Father.
Father, we've heard your word preached by a man who's already experienced today what he preached about 10 years ago. Father, we thank you that heaven surely will be worth it all. Lord, he's in the sweet by and by. We're in the nasty now. And Lord, we've got to be practicing until we get to heaven. We've got to be faithful till we get to glory. And Father, help us to be as faithful as Brother Frye was to the very end. Help us not to rust out, but Lord, help us burn out and go out in a blaze of glory until we're in your presence, in your place. Help us realize tonight heaven's not too far away. It's just a breath away. And Father, help us tonight come and ask you to help us to live and be faithful until you call us home. God, speak to us. Use this invitation to draw your people closer to you. I ask this in Jesus' name and for his sake. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed as they start this verse of invitation. God, speak. Come on right now. Heaven surely will be worth it all.
Father, Lord, we thank you, Jesus, for this wonderful day you've given us, Lord. Thank you for our many blessings. Lord, we just thank you so much for the opportunity that we had to be in your house today, Lord. Lord, we ask you just to please be with us, Lord, and bless us, God. And Lord, just help us just to fulfill your will for our lives, Lord. Just pray that you just help us to go out and uplift you in everything that we do, God. Lord, I just pray that you just put a burden on our hearts, Lord, and just help us just to go out and just win the lost and encourage your brethren, Lord. Pray that you just have your will and way in all of us, Lord, and we just thank you for all you do. For us in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.